Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is rural affairs, land reform and islands. As ever, any member wishing to ask a supplementary issue, press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. Question number one has not been lodged, so question two, Alec Rowley.
Presiding officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether any further action is required to address reported concerns around the environmental sustainability and welfare impact of farmed salmon.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
We have robust legislation, policies and operational practices in place to ensure farmers are meeting statutory requirements related to the environment, sustainability and welfare, such as sea lice reporting and management, mortality reporting and listed disease surveillance. And I do think it is important to recognise that Scotland's salmon industry is a significant contributor to our economy and particularly in rural and island communities. It produces high quality nutritious products with a lower carbon footprint than many other sources of farm protein. It's also important to highlight, too, our vision for sustainable aquaculture, which sets out how we will support the development of our aquaculture industry to operate within environmental limits and deliver social and economic benefits for Scotland.
Alec Rowley.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. As she is no doubt aware, there have been long-standing concerns around the welfare and environmental impact of farmed salmon. This has included ongoing reports of mass fish deaths on salmon farms, the increasing impact of sea lice in salmon farms, as well as increased use of chemicals and antibiotics to combat the levels of disease. Is the Scottish Government not concerned that these continuous reports of disease-ridden farms has very real potential to ruin the global reputation of Scottish salmon, and what more can be done and should be done about this issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, I do recognise some of the concerns that have been raised by Mr Rowley and completely understand wider public concern about fish health and mortality. But I think to touch on one example that was used just recently, there was misinformation that was reported last week in advance of a visit that had taken place by some committee members in the Parliament. And I think the misrepresentation of some of these issues shows a real lack of understanding of some operations. Now, notwithstanding that, I think the member has raised some really important issues there. And that's where I think it is, again, important to, first of all, touch on the work that we're taking through the Griggs Review and the recommendations that came out of that. When it comes to fish health and welfare, that is of paramount importance, and we're continually striving to improve that. And that's why that's a key pillar in terms of what we set out in our vision for sustainable aquaculture that we published last year, because we want to see improvements in fish health and fish welfare. I know that industry are committed to doing that and also to reducing mortalities to the lowest possible levels. We are continuing to engage in discussions with industry, with our regulators and more widely. I also chair the Scottish Aquaculture Council, which
briefly
brings together a range of different bodies to really try and address some of these issues too.
You know, I've got a couple of supplementaries. They'll need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Colin Beattie.
Can the Cabinet Secretary please tell the Chamber how many jobs the finfish aquaculture industry supports in rural Scotland, and set out some of the detail of the economic importance of this industry, both nationally and in rural and island communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
I want to thank Colin Beattie for that question, because I think it is really important to recognise the significant economic contribution that our fish farming sector makes to our rural economy and Scotland's economy more widely. I mean, when you look at the overall figures in relation to that, the industry was worth £1.2 billion at farm gate prices in 2022. It employs over 12,000 people right throughout the supply chain, but it also provides well-paid jobs in some of the most rural communities in Scotland and in our island communities too, and it makes a significant economic contribution.
And Edward Mount.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I remind members of my register of interest that I am a proprietor in a wild salmon fishery on the east coast of Scotland where there are no fish farms. We heard this morning that mortality for salmon farms was around 20 to 25%, been somewhat better this year because of colder seas. Given that the industry seemed to be predicting a 2% drop in mortality, How long do you think it should be before the industry should consider whether expansion is right until they've got fish mortality under control?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's important to remember that obviously there are a range of different issues that contribute to fish mortality. And of course, I know that industry would be committed to driving that to the lowest possible levels, as we are, and we would expect producers to drive that to the lowest possible levels, because it's not within anyone's interest to see high mortality from a fish health and welfare perspective, but also from an economic perspective as well. I know that the challenges that we're seeing industry and invest quite a lot in relation to research and innovation development to try and tackle some of those challenges. And I think that, again, as we recognise in our vision for sustainable aquaculture, the investment in innovation is going to be critical so that we can address some of the challenges that we see in relation to climate change and other issues going forward.
Question 3, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My apologies for being late to Chamber. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what assessment it has made of the impact of Brexit on Scotland's food and drink sector.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President. Officer. I think the easy answer we would say it has been very bad. But the food and drink sector has undoubtedly borne the brunt of Brexit, disrupting supply chains, creating new trade barriers and driving up food prices. The value of food imports from the EU into Scotland has fallen by 13% in value in 2023 compared to 2019. That slowdown is particularly acute for fruit and veg, down 51%, and for fish and seafood, down 67%. Many Scottish food industries are also suffering from lower exports to the EU, including a 45% fall in the value of fruit and veg exports between 2019 and 2023.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you, and thank the Minister for his answer. The Association of Independent Meat Suppliers, AIMS, has warned that failures in veterinary oversight and inaccuracies in certification processes are leaving UK businesses at risk of economic loss, waste and an increasingly unmanageable burden of bureaucracy. We know the way back to full benefits of the EU is with independence, but the Tories promised fewer trade barriers, no diminution of food standards and lower costs, while Labour remained silent on Brexit. So does the Minister agree that the UK Government must seek a new deal with the EU which reflects the wishes of the people of Scotland and gives us the benefits enjoyed by our Northern Ireland counterparts?
Minister.
Yeah, I absolutely agree, because the SNP is the only party in Scotland to advocate for rejoining the EU, not least to remove the Brexit harms like the one Claire Adamson has just highlighted. The new immigration rules that have been imposed, a minimum salary for vets who now require skilled worker visas, this is obviously adding costs and potentially impacting recruitment. And while we continue to work across the government, we continue to call for a negotiation with the EU and the UK for an SPS and a veterinary agreement, which would remove many of the Brexit barriers to benefit our businesses and consumers. It is our view that any such agreement should be comprehensive, it should be broad and deep, and this would offer the most benefits for Scotland. Indeed, one study undertaken by Aston University estimates that such an agreement could increase agri-food exports from the UK to the EU by at least 22.5%. But it's vital that devolved governments are central to any negotiations. Therefore, as always, we stand ready to work collaboratively to achieve the best possible results for Scottish consumers and businesses, and I hope the UK Government are minded to do the same.
Supplementary, Tim Eagle.
Presiding Officer, just to alert the Chamber to my register of interest as a small farmer. See, I don't think it's particularly helpful to continue to be talking about the negatives of Brexit coming up on 10 years post the vote. But a Quality Beef Scotland report last year revealed that red meat exports had in fact reached new highs of £93 million, 95% of which were export revenues generated in the EU market. However, QMS warned in that report that these sales were actually being limited by reduced abattoir provision in Scotland. So instead of talking down to Brexit all the time, will the Cabinet Secretary and Minister now take action to fix the abattoir shortage in Scotland?
Minister.
I'm afraid I'm just not buying that at all. To talk about the fact that there are no damage to the food and drink sector in Scotland, it has been catastrophic. So in terms of our ability to make sure that we continue to work in the abattoir sector, I think, as the Deputy Presiding Officer knows, we're already looking at that. But there are huge issues. And he talks about abattoirs. We can't get vets to come from Europe over here because of Brexit-imposed new wage restrictions. So I'm sorry, I just don't buy Tim Eagle's point at all.
Question 4, Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will increase funding to enable more trees of commercial species to be planted in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Despite the pressures on the Scottish Government's budget, nearly £40 million is available this year to support the planting of a wide range of woodland. The planting of timber-producing species is an important part of this balance and normally represents around half of the new planting in Scotland. Productive species also make up 60% of the restocking supported by the Forestry Grant Scheme. Now, while we're not able to increase funding this year for tree planting, we have introduced flexibility to adjust grant contributions so that existing funding is spread across more projects and enables the planting of more productive species.
Fergus Hewitt.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary will know that our sawmills, our panel products, contribute £1 billion a year to the economy, 25,000 jobs, and they can do far, far more because we import more timber than any country in the world except China. But without a continuous, regular, guaranteed, steady supply of commercial species, Presiding Officer, these businesses' future is in question. Now, if the Minister wants to know where the money can come from to plant to spend more on trees, could I suggest you take it from rewilding, peatland restoration of dubious value, and finally, to avoid throwing further millions of pounds on futile attempts to avoid the extinction of the capercaillie, surely the most expensive bird already in world avian history.
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, I think the member has made a few points there that I'll try and touch on. Now, there's no getting around the fact, and I've been quite transparent about this, in relation to the budget that we've seen for tree planting this year, we're absolutely not in the place that we would want to be. And I think especially when we've been on such a good trajectory for the levels of tree planting in Scotland, with 15,000 hectares planted over the course of the last year. And we did have a target of 18,000 hectares for this year, which unfortunately we're not going to be able to meet with the levels of funding that are available. But largely that's down to the massive cuts that we've received from the UK government, and a 10% to our capital budgets overall, which means that we are restricted in terms of what we can do. Now, I would say that a lot of these other areas, and one in particular that the member touched on in terms of peatland restoration, our peatland is responsible for about 15% of our emissions. So the funding we put into that and developing that industry to restore our peatlands is vitally important. But what's also important is that with the budget we do have, we maximise that and get as many trees in the ground as possible with what's available.
Brief supplementary, Finlay Carson.
Presiding Officer, Scotland's forestry sector achieved record tree planting last year, but budget cuts will limit new woodland creation to around 10,000 hectares this year. At this level, the sector advises both jobs and industry confidence will be lost, and the infrastructure for planting will shrink, consigning Scotland to years of failure. Given the sector's £1.1 billion annual contribution to Scotland's economy, will the Scottish Government provide the £10.5 million additional funding needed to prevent long-term industry damage?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, I think I've covered this point in my opening response, and that if that is funding that is to come from this year's in-year budget, I mean, I'd like some suggestions from the member as to where that funding could come from, because right now we simply do not have it. But what is really important is the work that the teams in Scottish Forestry are undertaking this year to, again, maximise the tree planting that we can undertake within the resources that we have available, and trying to be as flexible as possible within that and really make sure that we are making the best of the budgets that we do have.
Question 5, James Dornan, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what communication it has had with the UK Government since the general election regarding the potential impact on Scotland's food and drink sector of the reported proposal for not for EU labelling on food and drink products in the UK.
Minister.
Yeah, thanks, President Officer. Since the general election, officials have been meeting regularly with the UK Government officials to discuss their plans for the proposed GBE-wide not-for-EU labelling. And I'm pleased that the Government appears to be taking a more measured and evidence-based approach to the not-for-EU, and myself and the Cabinet Secretary are very keen to work together to develop a proportionate and workable solution to address some of the concerns around the free flow of goods into Northern Ireland.
James Dornan.
I thank the Minister for that answer and welcome the discussions that are taking place between both governments. Labelling is a wholly devolved matter, and policy decisions in this space should rest with Scotland's democratically elected government. GB-wide labelling proposals are merely another assault on Scotland's devolved political settlement, though, and I obviously welcome the abandonment of this scheme. But scrapping Tory schemes aside, does the Cabinet Secretary or the Minister have any further indications that Labour intend to deal differently from their predecessors in respect to this Parliament's and Scotland's government?
Minister.
The Scottish Government has made clear its commitment to working collaboratively with the UK Government in order to achieve better outcomes for Scotland. And we are working constructively with the UK Government on areas of common ground, such as helping the economy grow and transition to net zero in a way that respects devolution and all the powers of the Scottish Parliament. Indeed, myself and the Cabinet Secretary were in London just a few weeks ago to meet Steve Reid, the Secretary of State for Rural Affairs, Hugh Aranca Davis from the Welsh Government and Andrew Muir from the Northern Irish Government. We had a very positive, constructive discussion based around mutual respect for devolved competencies and a much closer, more collegiate working relationship, and we hope that becomes the norm.
Question 6, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what data it holds on the availability and prominence of Scottish food and drink produce in supermarkets operating in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Market data suggests that there were sales of £541 million in supermarkets on Scottish brands in 2023, with independent consumer insights commissioned by Scotland Food and Drink highlighting that Scottish consumers want to buy more Scottish products. That's why we've committed over £10 million over the course of 2023 to 2025 to support the delivery of Scotland's food and drink strategy, Sustaining Scotland, Supplying the World. And that strategy contains a number of actions to increase local sourcing and to get more of our quality products on supermarket shelves so that we can continue to ensure that consumers have increasingly easier access to Scottish products.
Willie Coffey.
The Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She'll be aware of some of the finest products available in my constituency and across Ayrshire, including Dunlop cheese, Darvel Dexter beef, Ayrshire Riviera cider, Lochlea whisky and, of course, the world-famous Kilmarnock pie. But not all of these, Presiding Officer, can be found in our supermarket shelves. Aldi, with the highest overall percentage of Scottish products at 49%, and Lidl, with 100% Scottish lamb, are the standouts. But our friends at Asda, Tesco and Sainsbury all appear to have less than 10% Scottish products on their shelves. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that all of us should be united in calling on supermarkets to back Scotland's food producers and buy Scotland's produce so that consumers can in turn do the same and enjoy our wonderful food and drink from every part of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, absolutely. I couldn't agree more with Willie Coffey's point there. And I think some of the facts that he mentioned there were in relation to, I think, some of the important work that's undertaken by NFUS and their shelf watch. And I believe that we're waiting on the results of the most recent iteration of that that they've undertaken. Now, retailers do know that people want to buy Scottish, and we are seeing more campaigns within retail settings providing leading positioning in store and marketing opportunities for more Scottish products than ever. But I would also just want to emphasise some of the work that we're undertaking to try and make that as easy as possible for people and to really try and increase these opportunities. So we are working with the Scottish Wholesale Association, Scottish Grocers Federation to try and increase sales through wholesale and convenience channels. We also host regional Sourcing Scotland Meet the Buyer events to ensure that we are linking up our retailers with some of the fantastic Scottish products that we have available. And that work will very much continue.
And brief supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Willie Coffey has highlighted some of the fantastic small and artisan producers that we have in East Ayrshire. We have them across Scotland, and the Cabinet Secretary mentions the amazing support from our wholesalers. But what can the Scottish Government do to help these businesses scale up and make sure they do have access to supermarket shelves?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
I would just re-emphasise some of the work that I've already mentioned there, because I appreciate the point that the Member is making. We want to see more Scottish products on shelves across Scotland in all sizes of stores and within our retailers. So I mentioned the Go Local programme there. That's about convenience stores and ensuring we have local products there. I also touched on the Meet the Buyer events, which are really important in getting and linking up some of our producers with the real retailers too. So I think it's by investing in that work and ensuring that we're building these relationships, we can hope to see more local produce on our shelves.
Question 7, Patrick Harvey.
Ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking in response to reported concerns that the licensing scheme introduced by the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Act 2023 is acting as a loophole in the fox hunting ban.
Minister.
The licensing scheme in the Act is not a loophole. The use of more than two dogs is strictly controlled under licence for specified purposes, in particular protection of livestock. All licence applications are scrutinised by Nature Scot, where licences are granted. Both Nature Scot and Police Scotland must be notified before any activity commences. Nature Scot have carried out a number of visits to ensure any activity undertaken is strictly in accordance with the licence. And Nature Scot are currently carrying out a planned review of the licensing scheme, and we will consider the findings and take any further action as required.
Patrick Harvey.
Parliament over many years has repeatedly voted in favour of ending fox hunting in Scotland, and in the most recent legislation, which was intended to close the loopholes that have been used by those continuing to perpetrate this cruel practice, the licensing regime which was introduced was intended to be for exceptional purposes, and the Scottish Government's own position was that fox hunting should have no place in a modern Scotland. Isn't it clear that with 41 licences issued in just the first hunting season since that Act's been in force, we simply do not have the rigorous enforcement of the legislation that we need? And will the Scottish Government ensure that the future sees a great deal more rigour applied?
Minister.
I simply disagree with the characterisation which Mr Harvey has put across. Fox hunting is absolutely against the principles of the people of Scotland, but predator control is not. And hunting with dogs, with more than two dogs, is licensed in specific circumstances to make sure that farm managers, landowners, can protect the livestock and the wildlife in their area.
Got a couple of supplementaries. They'll need to be brief, as will the responses. Emma Harper, firstly.
Criminal activity against wildlife must be pursued, and there is a straightforward way for concerned parties to do so. However, in rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway, it is crucial that farmers, conservationists and land managers have access to methods of species management and predator control. Does the Minister agree, and can he reaffirm that this will remain the Scottish Government's position?
Briefly, Minister.
I can absolutely agree that the Scottish Government's position is to allow predator control as we go forward.
Thank you. I'm Rachel Hamilton, briefly.
Presiding officer, no wonder the SNP dumped their hapless coalition with the Greens. Patrick Harvey and his colleagues passed the Hunting with Dogs Bill, which ensured a licensed approach. Furthermore, NatureScot have strengthened the licensing process, making it more difficult for PACs to get a licence. Can the Minister confirm how many times the licence conditions have been broken?
Minister.
At this moment, to my knowledge, there has been none.
And question 8, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the first statutory national islands plan published in 2019 has been a success.
Cabinet Secretary.
The implementation of the first national islands plan has faced a succession of crises since its introduction, including the COVID-19 pandemic, the ongoing cost crisis and the full effects of Brexit. However, significant policy efforts and investments have been delivered across government to drive progress towards the strategic objectives of the plan. Now, we know that more remains to be done to address islands' priorities and to help them fulfil their ambitions, and that's why we've announced that a new plan will be published next year, and we will continue to be guided by islanders to inform its content.
Jamie Green.
Well, I think the answer to that question was no, it hasn't been a success, and there seems to be a litany of excuses given by the Minister as why it hasn't provided better outcomes for islands. I mean, I think we all know the reality. Life on island communities is difficult, but it simply got worse. The availability and affordability of housing, access to health and social care, education, the growth of businesses, depopulation, and let's not mention, of course, the F word, the continuous chaos on our ferry network. So what hope can we give islanders from this, their national parliament, that the next National Islands Plan will be worth more than the paper it's written on?
Ms. Secretary.
I know that the Tories would just like to brush over all the key issues that I've mentioned, and you know some of them that they were largely responsible for as well, let alone the massive cuts to our budgets that we've seen over previous years as well. But that's why this government is committed to delivering for our islands. Now, as I've already set out, we're after a consultation earlier last year, we committed to bringing forward a new National Islands Plan, which will be based around what our islanders see as being important, and some of it will be driven by the objectives that they want to try and address, and we'll set out how the government will be delivering across those objectives. So we look forward to the process of developing that plan and working with our islanders as we do it.
Again, both supplementaries here, but brevity again will be required. Katie Clark first.
My office is contacted on an almost daily basis about problems with the ferry service. For example, yesterday a constituent phoned about a service which was diverted to Troon and about the conditions on board. Does the Cabinet Secretary not agree that the government's handling of the ferry crisis has undermined the strategic goals of their National Islands Plan?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, I recognise that when it comes to our infrastructure, whether that's our transport infrastructure, housing and these other matters, that are of critical importance to our islands and the people that live on them. Now, in relation to some of the particular points around ferries, if there are any issues that the member would like to raise, then I would, of course, ask that she raise them with the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, who will respond to her on those matters. But again, that's why the National Islands Plan and the development of that is so important, because it looks at all the issues that matter to our islanders and sets out how the government will address those in the coming years. And we also publish how we are doing and performing against those objectives every year as well. So I look forward to members feeding into that process.
And briefly, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Islands Plan discussed improving the quality of life for island communities. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for some concrete examples of how the SNP has done just that since the plan's publication? And can she also remind the Chamber of the impacts of Tory austerity and the Tory cost of living crisis on our island communities? They're complaining, but that is the legacy of the Tories in the islands.
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
It's undoubtedly had a huge impact, not least on the 10% cut to our capital budgets that we've seen. But what I would highlight that is, in spite of that, we've still continued to deliver an islands programme, which has delivered for 61 different projects across 50 different islands with over £12 million of funding. And we're set to announce shortly what will be the outcome of the most recent applications to that programme, where there is a further £3 million worth of investment planned.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs and islands. There will be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move to the next portfolio. Okay, and the next portfolio is health and social care. Again, any member wishing to ask a supplementary should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. Brevity would be appreciated, given the number of supplementaries already indicated. I call question number one, Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is in place to help newly qualified paramedics find suitable employment.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is committed to attracting a diverse workforce into NHS employment and hugely values the role of our paramedics, who provide effective person-centred care for the people of Scotland. We work closely with the Scottish Ambulance Service to set numbers annually for the university student intake programme for those who wish to study to become a paramedic, and with overall responsibility for the recruitment of newly qualified paramedics resting with the Scottish Ambulance Service. We continue to work with SAS to explore how the role of a paramedic can be utilised more widely within the healthcare system to improve patient care in areas of high demand.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I've been contacted by a constituent who graduated with a distinction in their paramedical science degree. They are now a registered paramedic and were informed that they had a job with the Scottish Ambulance Service after passing the interview process. Despite this, my constituent advised that the closest job posting that they were offered would involve an unmanageable daily commute, and they were then advised that if they did not accept this remote posting, their application would be void and they would have to reapply for a position next year. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what support can the Scottish Government give to those paramedics who do not receive a posting offer close to their home?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. I thank Fulton McGregor for bringing this to the Chamber. I commend Fulton McGregor's constituent for their progress, and I obviously sympathise with them in terms of their situation as they see it at the moment. As autonomous institutions, health boards are responsible for their own recruitment activity. The Scottish Government is not directly involved in such recruitment plans and processes, and the Scottish Ambulance Service remains committed to maximising the opportunities for newly qualified paramedics to find employment, and we continue to support them in this endeavour, with paramedic numbers up by 46.9% in the last 10 years. So while it's hoped that all graduates can join SAS within their chosen location upon graduation, this is not always possible, as vacancies in each area can fluctuate significantly each year, depending on factors such as local retention and absence rates.
Supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
I know that ambulance technicians who want to train as paramedics are unable to access training places due to a lack of funding. So can I ask what steps will the Cabinet Secretary take to make it easier for technicians to retrain as paramedics, especially given paramedic vacancies have been steadily increasing since 2016?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Jackie Bailey for that question. That's something I'll take away and consider. In terms of where we are with paramedic numbers, obviously, we've, I've pointed out to Fulton MacGregor where paramedic places are up, paramedics in particular are up by 46.9%. Ambulance technicians are up by 32.4% in that same period. And in terms of the resourcing, Scottish Ambulance Service's resource budget has increased by 29.9% in real terms between 2010-11 and 2024-25. But I will take away the point that Jackie Bailey raises and see if there's more that we can do.
Question 2, Lorna Slater.
To ask the Scottish Government how many alcohol-related deaths were reported in the Lothians region for the last year in which data is available.
Minister Jenny Minto.
The number of alcohol-specific deaths in 2023 was published by National Records of Scotland on the 10th of September 2024. For the NHS Lothian Health Board area, there were 163 alcohol-specific deaths in 2023, an increase of 10 deaths from the 153 deaths reported in 2022.
Lorna Slater.
I'm sure the Minister will agree with me that this is too many. The Scottish Greens secured a commitment in the most recent Scottish Budget for the Scottish Government to reconsider the reintroduction of the public health supplement. This would be a small surcharge on the non-domestic rates for large retailers selling alcohol and tobacco, recognising the harm that these products can cause and the cost to the public purse of treating those harms. Research by the Fraser of Allender Institute, commissioned by Alcohol Focus Scotland, has found that the public health levy could raise approximately £57 million of additional funding for public services. Does the Minister agree that we cannot pass up the chance to invest tens of millions more in addiction services with a public health levy?
Minister.
I thank Lorna Slater for her supplementary question and agree that one death due to alcohol is a death too many, and I send my sincerest heartfelt apologies to families that have been impacted by this. The public health levy is still being considered, is still under consideration by the Scottish Government, but I'd also just like to point out that minimum unit pricing of alcohol has increased this week as well.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. I'll try to get as many as I can, but again, brevity will be required. First, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, or the Minister, sorry, to provide further information regarding the implementation of the minimum unit price increase and how this is anticipated to help reduce alcohol harm?
Minister.
I thank Claire Adamson for her question. The Scottish Government has engaged broadly with key business associations and retailer groups to ensure maximum awareness of the minimum unit price of alcohol increasing to 65 pence from the 30th of September. We have also collaborated with trade bodies and industry representatives to produce a variety of materials for retailers to use in store to help inform customers and raise awareness of the price increase. We have also co-funded guidance to retailers produced by the Scottish Grocers Federation. And our business and regulatory impact assessment published earlier this year, based on modelling undertaken by the University of Sheffield, set out that in the first year, deaths from all causes were estimated to reduce by 60 compared to the control group of continuing MUP at the same level in real terms when adjusted for inflation.
Briefly, Sue Webber.
Minister, the decision to close the life-saving alcohol-related brain damage unit in NHS Lothian has been paused while options are being assessed. There is no other ARBD-specific residential rehab unit in Scotland, and evidence shows that the treatment for people with ARBD in non-specialist units is often unsatisfactory. On the 4th of July, the Scottish Government requested clarification on the function of the service to allow it to be reclassified as specialist rehabilitation unit. This information has been provided, yet no response has been received. Minister, do you agree that the classification is crucial for funding, and will you seek to determine what is preventing this life-saving service from being assessed as a rehabilitation unit?
Through to you, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sue Webber asked me a question on this a couple of weeks ago, and I recognise that we are still waiting for a response to that, so I'm very happy to engage with officials and understand what the delays have been and get back to the member.
Thank you. Carol Mochan, briefly.
Thank you. The Minister will know that people in the most deprived areas are 7 times more likely to end up in hospital due to alcohol-related conditions. Certain hospitals serve a disproportionate number of such areas. Can the Minister detail if anything is being done to provide extra support for those hospitals, specifically for accident and emergency departments, which are reportedly seeing increased presentations of people at risk from serious alcohol harms?
Minister.
I thank Carol Mochan for the question. I don't have specific information with regard to that question here, but I would like to remind the member that alcohol and drug partnerships have had record levels of funding this year, and I will respond to your direct question in writing.
And very briefly, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Everyone cares about alcohol deaths, and given the significant work of organisations including the Portman Group and Community Alcohol Partnerships, which support local partnerships that reduce alcohol harm, particularly among children and young people, will the Minister and the Government commit to listening carefully to the very real concerns of the industry as they consult on new measures to restrict alcohol marketing and sponsorship?
Minister.
Craig Hoy for the question, and as part of any consultation process the Government is very clear that we need to consult and engage with business as well as stakeholders, and that will be being done with regards to this.
Question 3, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support neurodivergent people in light of reports of people waiting years for diagnosis and subsequent access for support and treatment, which is seriously impacting their lives.
Minister Marie Todd.
There have been significant increases in neurodivergent people seeking a diagnosis and requiring support. Whilst this creates challenges for a range of services, we also recognise how important a diagnosis and support can be. We're working closely with NHS health boards and local authorities to improve services and support for neurodivergent people. And we published a national neurodevelopmental specification in 2021, setting out the standards that all children's services should follow to ensure that access to support is effective and consistent across Scotland, supported by funding including £1 million for tests of change. Neurodivergent children and young people also benefit from the £15 million per annum provided to local authorities for community-based supports and the £120 million provided to NHS boards under the Enhanced Mental Health Outcomes Framework.
Karen Adam.
The Minister for that answer. There have been reports that some people are waiting more than 4 years for diagnosis of autism and ADHD, and many of those undiagnosed or waiting for treatment are struggling with school and employment. Has the Scottish Government considered providing a fast-track approach to diagnosis and access and treatment post-diagnosis? And can the Scottish Government please give an update regarding pauses to treatment as a result of medicine shortages?
Minister.
So we want patients to get the help they need when they need it, and we understand how important a timely ADHD or autism diagnosis is for individuals. We also recognise the pressure that services face given the rapid but welcome gains in awareness, and that's why we continue to fund and work with the National Autism Implementation Team to support health and social care partnerships to consider best practice and improve service in the redesigning of neurodevelopmental diagnostic services. We would expect employers or schools to explore with individuals what adjustments are appropriate, as formal diagnosis isn't required for educational adjustments or for disabled people to receive support through access to work. The supply of medicines, the second part of your question, that's a reserved matter for the UK Government. Information provided by the UK Government indicates that some of these ADHD supply issues will continue into winter 2024. The shortages are caused by a combination of manufacturing issues and an increase in demand, and anyone who's affected should speak directly to their clinical team.
And very brief supplementary, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There's information that can help whether or not you actually get a diagnosis or not, such as diet, exercise, sleep. What information can be extended to people so they can wait well?
Minister, briefly.
So the member is absolutely correct, and that's one of the things we talk about regularly in this chamber, is that support and particularly adjustments should be possible without a diagnosis. The whole improvement that is possible in the individual doesn't actually require a diagnosis to be in place, and we invest a great deal in community supports in order to make sure that those are easily accessible to people who suspect they have a neurodivergent diagnosis. A diagnosis isn't needed to access help in Scotland.
Question 4, Alexander Stewart.
Planning officer, to ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to ensure that diagnostic pathways in Scotland are appropriate for those affected by brain tumours.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. We know that diagnosing brain cancer can be challenging as symptoms are wide-ranging and often vague. We continue to work with primary care to ensure they have direct access to diagnostic tests and quality education sources. A clinical review of the Scottish referral guidelines for suspected cancer is underway, and a new national headache referral pathway has been published to ensure the right patient is on the right pathway at the right time. We are opening another rapid cancer diagnostic service in 24-25, bringing our national total to 6. These services are ruling cancer in or out faster for those with non-specific symptoms, supporting our earlier cancer diagnosis vision.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. Can I ask what steps the Scottish Government is taking to ensure GPs direct access to imaging, specifically CT head imaging, for those with non-specific symptoms but which are suspect of being cancer, such as a brain tumour? And are they being regularly monitored to ensure the pathway is utilised efficiently and effectively?
Minister.
Thank Alexander Stewart for his question, and that is exactly the reason that the rapid cancer diagnostic centres have been, services have been set up, and that's exactly the pathway that I would be expecting to happen.
Brief supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In March, I hosted a members' debate to mark Brain Tumour Awareness Month. Many members highlighted the need of greater research to improve outcomes for those living with brain tumours. I welcome the announcement of the Scottish Brain Tumour Research Centre of Excellence in July. Can the Minister advise if the Scottish Government has engaged with the centre since its launch and how it plans to support its research into the most aggressive form of brain cancer?
Briefly, Minister.
I thank Faisal Chowdhury for his question, and yes, the Scottish Government engages regularly with the Brain Tumour Research Centre. I too have met with Brain Tumour Research in September this year, and it was agreed that they would send a funding proposal to support brain tumour research in Scotland to the Chief Scientist Office, and I'm looking forward to the outcome of that, and I believe next week we have the inaugural meeting of the cross-party group, and I would hope to see Mr Chowdhury at that.
Question 5, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what compensation is available for any families that are paying for private urgent dental treatment due to delays in accessing NHS treatment.
Minister Jenny Minto.
In primary care dental services, where a patient is registered for NHS dental services and has an urgent dental problem, they should be seen as soon as possible by their NHS dental practice and treated in line with their clinical priority. Unregistered patients are able to access urgent and emergency care via public dental service clinics. In common across the whole of NHS care provision, there is no compensation available when patients choose to seek healthcare privately.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, the Minister, for that answer. A constituent in my region was told that her daughter had a severe dental condition which required urgent orthodontic treatment in a hospital. There, they were told it would be an 18-month wait as there was no consultant available to carry out treatment. They were left with no choice but to seek treatment privately, as there was a threat that if left untreated, her daughter could lose all her front teeth, which would have a lifelong impact. This treatment would normally be funded through the NHS, but because there was no consultant available, a private route had to be sought. What steps is the Government taking to address consultant shortages in NHS dental services, particularly in Ayrshire and Arran?
Minister.
I thank Sharon Dowie for her question. This summer I visited the dental centre in Glasgow and had exactly that conversation with people there. We, as the Scottish Government, are supporting NHS boards to drive improvements in secondary care waiting times and are targeting resources to ensure people waiting the longest are treated as soon as possible. We are also driving improvements in children's oral health through our flagship Child Smile programme. I recognise that's on the prevention side and not directly what Sharon Dowie was asking about. But we are working closely with NHS boards to ensure that they are making the most efficient use of their surgeries and clinical time to reduce waiting lists, to improve the care that young families are getting with regard to their dental.
Question 6, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it can provide to NHS Ayrshire and Arran in light of reports that the Health Board requires over £85 million to cover the cost of backdated repairs.
One second.
Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish Government is working with all health boards to develop a whole system infrastructure plan. In the context of a very challenging financial position, this is a positive and practical approach that will support the continued safe operation of existing facilities, as well as the determination of longer-term investment priorities.
Katie Clark.
Arran War Memorial Hospital requires over £1.2 million of repairs, Ayrshire Central over £6 million, Crosshouse Hospital over £32 million, Ailsa Hospital over £10 million, Ayr Hospital over £16 million, Townhead Surgery almost £700,000, and the list goes on. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the deteriorating state of NHS buildings has a negative impact on quality of care?
Cabinet Secretary.
I want to see an improved situation with regards to the capital position for the NHS and investment in our infrastructure for part of the reasons that Katie Clark outlines. She'll be well aware of the infrastructure investment review that's currently going on across government, and I am doing what I can within my portfolio to ensure that there's a prioritisation of capital investment. That would be made much easier if we had capital investment coming from a UK government level as well, rather than what we have at the moment, which is a proposal for a near 9% cut in our capital provision, £1.3 billion less, which obviously does not help in us being able to fix our NHS estate.
And very briefly, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the biggest problems we have within the NHS in terms of capital projects is we still don't have a basic technology platform that enables the countrywide adoption of AI and technology. So I can ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government are doing to enable this swift adoption of technology and give healthcare professionals the tools they need to tackle the backlog.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's very gracious of you, Presiding Officer. We are embarking on work. It is a priority of mine in terms of the reform and improvement work that we need to see undergone across the NHS, that we are better applying innovation that is out there to our health service. That is the way that we're going to see continued improvement. The work that's been led by the Chief Scientific Officer Office is leading on this, including, I would point Mr Whittle to the ANIA programme, which is about having a Once for Scotland adoption of good innovation practice. And I'd be happy to refer Mr Whittle to that.
I commend your adaptability. Question 7, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will publish revised modelling to show any impact of delays to the opening of the remaining national treatment centres on bringing down waiting lists, as outlined in its NHS recovery plan.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The national treatment centres in operation at Highland Fife, the National Eye Centre, and the new surgical centre at NHS Golden Jubilee and NTC Forth Valley, which will begin treating patients this month, will provide around 20,000 additional procedures annually. I've acknowledged that this is less than the full NTC programme set out in the NHS recovery plan, given that new health capital projects are currently subject to review, including the 5 planned NTCs not currently in construction. We're therefore investing the resources available to us now to deliver additional activity, and this year's £30 million additional investment into waiting times is projected to deliver over 60,000 additional appointments and procedures, with significant additional activity already underway.
Mark Griffin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In 2021, the then First Minister promised Cumbernauld a new national treatment centre, but there has been no sign of it since. The Cabinet Secretary will know that waiting lists for inpatient and day cases stand at 11,500 in NHS Lanarkshire, with 2,500 of those waiting over a year. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, when will the Government make good on their promise for a national treatment centre for Cumbernauld in Lanarkshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, and I thank Mark Griffin for his question. I'm pleased to report that as part of our investment in waiting times finance, we are seeing latest figures showing that NHS inpatient and day case activity has increased. Inpatient day case activity for quarter two was the highest since the start of the pandemic, the 10th quarterly increase in a row, with 65,106 patients seen in quarter two, up from by 1.6% in the last quarter, and 9.9% 9% on quarter two last year. I would say to Mark Griffin, as I did to Katie Clark, that our ability to invest in capital projects within the health service and in, across the rest of government would be made much easier if we see at the budget at the end of October an investment in capital, an investment in our public services, an investment in our people and our economy, rather than what we're getting from newspaper reports is the Treasury asking for capital savings from Whitehall departments. That's continued austerity that's going to harm our health service.
I'll get in the supplementary if it's brief and the response is likewise clear. Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest and that I hold an NHS Great Glasgow and Clyde bank nurse contract. The National Treatment Centres are playing a key role in bringing down wait lists in Scotland. However, it's of considerable concern that the opening of new centres has been delayed as a result of the UK Government cuts to Scotland's capital budget. Will the Cabinet Secretary join me in calling on our Labour members in this chamber to join with us and press their colleagues at Westminster to reverse this cut as a priority so that this work can be progressed?
Cabinet Secretary, briefly.
So I thank Claire Hawkey for her question, and yes, I do. She's absolutely right. The National Treatment Centres in operation are making a difference, as is the investment that we're making in waiting times. But the capital funding position is extremely challenging. An expected 8.7% real terms cut to our UK capital budget in the medium term. That's because the Labour Party is at Westminster is following the Tory spending plans. That is a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion. So ahead of the budget this month, I would urge the UK Government to reflect on Lord Darzley's findings and previous calls from this government and organisations such as the IMF to prioritise investment in infrastructure and public services. We need that to happen.
Question 8, Rachel Hamilton.
Ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the use of locums in local mental health services.
Minister Marie Todd.
The use of temporary staff in an organisation as large and complex as NHS Scotland will always be required to ensure vital service provision during times of unplanned absence, sickness and increased unforeseen activity. It's critical that we seek to secure the best value whenever we are delivering mental health services within NHS Scotland, allowing us to maximise the impact that our investment has on the quality and availability of patient care. We're working with colleagues across NHS Scotland to explore how we can reduce our reliance on agency staffing for both nursing and medical staff.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank Marie Todd for that answer, but an FOI revealed that the cost of agency locums in the Borders has tripled in the past 3 years, reaching over £7 million in 22-23. Furthermore, locums have made up to a third of the consultant psychiatrists' workforce in the Borders, with 75% not holding their certificate of completion of training. Cabinet Secretary, this is concerning and precarious. Why has the SNP Government chosen to decimate mental health services for my Borders constituents?
Minister.
No, I recognise that, I suppose the context is that there is a global shortage of psychiatrists, and I recognise that whilst things are improving in many areas of Scotland, there are challenges in recruiting to particular areas. My own area in Highland is impacted in the same way as the Borders has been. It is undoubtedly more difficult to recruit to particular geographical areas and to particular specialties within psychiatry. So learning disability psychiatrists are fewer and further between. We do have in place a medical locum engagement task and finish group co-chaired by the NHS Fife Chief Executive and Scottish Government's Director of Health Workforce, which has now been established to ensure appropriate locum usage across NHS Scotland. And that task and finish group is exploring the case for a set of identified interventions.
Thank you. And very briefly, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Health Boards in Scotland spent £30 million on locum psychiatrists in 2022. So can the Minister confirm if she thinks this expenditure is best value for money and how much was spent on locum psychiatrists in the last financial year?
Briefly, Minister.
So I'll need to get back in writing to the member with the second part of that question. Undoubtedly, as I said at the very beginning of my answer, there is no doubt that in an organisation as large and complex as NHS Scotland, it is appropriate to hire temporary staff at time. And hiring temporary staff is a better outcome than having the service delivery fail entirely. We need to work towards having more locum psychiatrists employed in permanent full-time posts. I hear time and time again from people who are accessing mental health care that they would like that continuity of care, and I assure the member that we are working towards that in Scotland.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on health and social care. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.